Minimum boundaries, and this is a joint work with Nestor Guillen. He's a student, a student of Luis Caffarelli. Most of this work I'm going to present is like this program on Luis Caffarelli and this group of local minimum circle. Okay, right, so I'm going to present some background quickly on the nonlocal minimum surfaces, and then main result of almost nonlocal. We have some precise definitions, some examples, then sketch of the proof, very big sketch of the proof and conclusion of nonlocal problems. There are lots of open problems regarding this. So what I'm here is really a heuristic introduction to the nonlocal minimum surfaces. So suppose that let omega be a compact set and let the Q of omega be its characteristic function, and omega c the complement of omega, then let's consider the heat equation ut minus Laplacian of u equals zero with initial data uk, where uk is given by this difference, the characteristic function of omega k minus the characteristic function of the complement of omega. And now we're going to consider this discrete approximation to mean curvature flow. So let's define omega k plus 1 to be equal to the set where the function u, perhaps u sub k, should we say here, is strictly positive. Let sk be the boundary of this domain. Then if delta is of the same order of epsilon squared, then now, the reason why I mentioned this is because something analogous can be done in the context of the, like, we can replace the Laplacian by the fractional Laplacian. So we can consider the equation ut plus the sigma Laplacian equals zero, where sigma is in the range between zero and one. So this already, I have here, this is like in the long range correlation, and this happens in few in Levy processes, for instance. Now, it turns out that when sigma is in the range between 1/2 and 1, if we look at this flow, we can recover the mean curvature flow, like the discrete approximation I showed earlier. While in the range between 0 and 1/2, then this problem gives rise to a flow with velocity given at the point p naught by this quantity. So we have the integral over run of the characteristic function omega minus the characteristic function of its complement divided by p minus the power n plus 2 sigma. So we have this kernel, 1 over p minus p naught to the power n plus 2 sigma. So now, heuristically, the stationary solutions to this flow are going to be these nonlocal minimum. So as a stationary solution to mean curvature flow or minimal boundaries, then we're going to call a non-local minimal set stationary solution to this flow. But let's see, okay, let's go on and let me say something more. Now let's set s to be equal to sigma. So now s is between 0 and 1. A way we can define a non-local minimal surface is by the following. A non-local minimal surface, it can be seen is the surface with the boundary of a set whose characteristic function minimizes the fraction of sub-LF norm, which is the norm HS over 2, S is more than 1/2, and degeneralized classical minimal surfaces. I'm going to say a few words about this in a bit. So now, well, for those of you who were yesterday at the public lecture, the public lecture was about the identifying something that somebody else has said eventually using mathematics. So just in case, I wrote here that Luis Caffarelli said it. Okay, so maybe you won't understand, but so let's go. Yeah. All right, so Luis Caffarelli has this interpretation to justify this terminology. So when we look at a diffusion equation, then the variable under consideration, temperature, probability density, the speed of a flow, tries to revert to an average of itself in a surrounding infinitesimal neighbor. So for instance, minimal surfaces, so the surface configuration, so then our soft film or elastic membrane attached to the barrier. Now, if we look at an integral diffusion, which is what we're going to have for nonlocal minimal surfaces, then the surface diffusion perceives long ranges from the interactions taking place on both sides of the surface. So this is the terminology nonlocal comes from here. So nonlocal minimal surfaces, therefore, are going to be equilibrium configurations for phasing transitions with long range interactions. So there is there is an article paper by Caffarelli's Zanidis about they study some propagation problem and they study this type of discretization of the fractional Laplacian coordinate that I suggested earlier. So this is in Armand 2010. And here, what we mean by integral diffusions, for instance, are Levy processes, they come into optimal control, green theory, finance, and continuum mechanics. So these nonlocal minimal surfaces, which are a critical point for certain function, which I'm going to introduce soon, like the precise definition, the regularity theory has been recently studied by Caffarelli, Rocchegiorgio, and Savi in an article that just came out in CIPA. And what they show is that, in analogy with, they show a little bit less, but they prove that these nonlocal surfaces are smooth except in a set of a constant dimension n minus 2. But they're working from incrementals without. So the big result that I want to, that Nestor and myself worked on is like working on almost nonlocal minimal surfaces. So yesterday we heard that Camilo talking about almost bound minimal surfaces. So what's roughly speaking an almost minimal surface, so nonlocal? Perhaps I'm going to be saying nonlocal. It means that the surface, if we make a small perturbation of this surface, then the energy will decrease but not too much. Might decrease but not too much, and I'm going to quantify this with precise definition. So what we show is we show that if we have an almost minimal surface, which is flat at your point, then it has a continuum, the surface around the point is going to be smooth, so it has a continuously changing normal. And this is our theorem. So suppose that E is the AJS rho delta minimal set in V1. I'm going to give it a definition of what does this mean. JS is going to be our functional. This is a, we borrowed this terminology by Armagram's terminology for almost a minimal surface. So suppose that we have E a minimal set in V1, then it will satisfy some assumptions. And well, I say here next slide, but I'm cheating. I'm not writing up all the assumptions. These are the classical assumptions for the classical theory. So I have an example that I will show. That's why I say next slide. Then we can see that there exists a delta naught, which defines an S and rho, such that if E is a delta naught flat in V1, then we can prove that the boundary is C1 in the smaller ball. So definition, so what does it mean that SLT is delta flat in a ball of radius R, center X naught? We say this if we look at the boundary of B intersection with the ball of radius R, center X naught, then this is contained on A cylinder X minus X naught dot E with height delta R. So now, let's get into the definition of this function. So to define it, the function that we're going to minimize. So given an intermeasurable set, 5 minutes. Okay, so given an intermeasurable set and B, and S between 0 and 1, we can define this quantity here. And let me see, let me just go to the next slide. So we have L of AB is going to be this double integral. And in particular, when we replace A and B by E and its complement, we recover the HS2 norm of the practice function of E squared, buffer constant. So now, the function we're going to minimize is the following. So what we do is we look at the localized energy in a fixed domain omega, and we define a function of JS E omega to be equal to the contribution in omega B and the interaction between the part of min omega with its complement and the complement of min omega and with the E minus omega. So this is our functional. And this is now the formal definition of a more almost minimal set. So we say that E is almost minimal if for every F, a set F, such that E and F are equal outside the modal radius R, then the following holds true. So the energy of E is valued by the energy of F plus this error, okay, this where we have some conditions that the modulus of continuity rho, and this, for instance, are satisfied by the function T to the alpha smaller than S. And for the precise conditions, we borrowed the conditions, as I said earlier, of the classical theory and Ammergren's memoir, Tamanini's monograph. So let's see some examples of almost minimal sets, non-local. And here we are redoing the theory in the classical theory. So of course, minimal boundaries will be almost minimal boundaries. And then also, if you look at the smooth boundaries, so if you look at a function U and the subgraph of a function U which is smooth, then also we're going to have here an almost minimal set. For instance, we can look at the obstacle problem, so boundaries of least energy line above an obstacle. I'm going to go fast here. And for, in another, again, from classical theory, also we can think of boundaries which describe non-local mean curvature. Now, the non-local mean curvature is the velocity v that I introduced earlier. So that's integral over Rn, curvature function of v minus curvature function is complement divided by x minus x naught to the power n plus s. So that would be the non-local mean curvature at the point x naught. And so these problems, for instance, the boundaries would describe non-local mean curvature appear in phase transition problems. Where the mean curvature of the interface depends on the pressure is related to the pressure temperature. So the sketch of the proof is similar to the proof of classical theory here, though we have to take care of the fact that we have long range interactions, so we have some terms to take care of. And so first step is to prove a volume density estimate. Then we need to show that the minimizers of this function are satisfied. So the Euler Lagrange equation, in fact, here we have inequalities. We could have the equation and we have some inequalities and so on. Then there is, the key new ingredient here is the partial Lagrange estimate, which is crucial for the proof of improvement of flatness. We require a compactness and block argument. This partial Lagrange estimate was introduced by Ovidio Salin, and it simplifies quite a lot also, where he proved the regularity theory also for classical minimal surfaces, like as, together with the other results. And then, okay, here as well, we end up with the monotonicity formula, and we show the existence of tangent cones. The monotonicity formula in this context is obtained using the extension problem introduced by Caparelli and Silvestre for the fractional attachment. So it's the same flavor of, classical. But one has to be careful that there are like terms that there are five ways to take care of. So here, a motivation for the Euler Lagrange equation, which I'm going to present, right? Maybe I will not present, but I am first. One of the first things we do is the maximum principle. I'm just going to skip this. And then this would be our Euler Lagrange inequality, if you wish. So we build some special perturbation sets. so on. So now the application of the problems, and then I finish. So, well, is this like if we let S go to 1, we can recover then the function JS converges to the perimeter. And so, in our proofs, like all the estimates that we get, does not depend, well, since we have still to check all the details, they don't depend on us. Things like that, so perhaps we can recover the theory on when the Giorgi Tamanini. And so, this something we are just, we are really at the beginning of it, would be interested to study sort of with people and make curvature flow for this problem. And I'll end here. Thank you so much for your attention.
Questions?
Can we get to C1 alpha?
Yeah, yeah.
So, this, okay.
Yeah.
And
similar, really, like to what you just.
With these obstacle problems, you also know that sort of the C1 alpha norm of the obstacle controls the C1 alpha norm?
Yes,